Hello friends, today we will be learning about a very important topic, which is occlusion in complete dentures. The important topics being covered in this video are condylar guidance, where we will learn how it is measured and its importance in balanced occlusion. Incisal guidance, which forms an integral part of occlusion, its measurement and significance has been discussed in detail while explaining the Hanau squint. The curve of Spee and the other compensatory curves and their contribution to the development of balanced occlusion. All the topics explained in this video are provided in the description below. So now let's start with the definition of occlusion according to GPT-9. It is defined as the static relationship between the incising or masticating surfaces of the maxillary or mandibular teeth or tooth analogs. This diagram will help us understand the definition of occlusion. Now here, these are the maxillary teeth and these are the mandibular teeth. The static relationship between these two is what is known as occlusion. Prior to selection and arrangement of the artificial teeth, the type of occlusal scheme is planned. It is very important to understand on how the correct selection of occlusal scheme can help in successfully replacing natural teeth with artificial teeth. It is therefore essential to understand the differences in the occlusion of artificial teeth and natural teeth and their nature of transfer of forces. So now let's try and understand the important differences between natural teeth and artificial teeth. While remembering points for natural teeth, remember this diagram to recollect points. While remembering points for artificial teeth, remember this diagram to recollect points. So the first point is, incising with the anterior teeth does not affect posteriors, since each natural tooth acts as an independent unit. However, in the artificial teeth, incising with anterior teeth of a denture affects all the teeth. Second point is the presence of proprioception in the natural teeth. This proprioception is, however, absent in the artificial teeth. The third point is, bilateral balanced occlusion is not present in the natural teeth. Whereas balanced occlusion may be necessary during the fabrication of a denture. Now let's continue with the differences between natural teeth and artificial teeth. Natural teeth respond individually to forces of occlusion. However, All artificial teeth respond as one single unit and move on the denture basis. Malocclusion present in the natural teeth may not cause damage for a long period. Whereas malocclusion in the artificial teeth always causes immediate damage. Non-vertical lateral forces are well tolerated by the natural teeth. However, non-vertical forces generated by artificial teeth are traumatic to the supporting tissues. Now let's discuss the requirements of complete denture occlusion. The first requirement is stability of occlusion in centric and eccentric relations. The presence of interferences and the absence of stability will interfere in the correct functioning of a denture. The second requirement is that the occlusal forces should be directed towards the center of the ridge. Forces directed off the ridge will result in the tipping of the dentures. The third requirement is that there should be a good cutting and shearing efficiency of the artificial teeth. A good cutting efficiency will ensure good mastication and healthy nutrition to the patient. The fourth requirement is the need for a favorable tooth-to-ridge position for functional liver balance. The absence of correct position will affect the masticatory efficiency of the denture. Now let's discuss the different types of complete denture occlusion. The first type is balanced occlusion. The second one is monoplane occlusion. And the third one is lingualized occlusion. Now let's start with balanced occlusion, which is a very important topic. The definition of balanced occlusion according to GPT-9 is the bilateral simultaneous occlusal contact of the anterior and posterior teeth in excursive movement. The words bilateral simultaneous and excursive movements should be remembered while defining balanced occlusion. This diagram will help you understand what is balanced occlusion. Here you can see the maxillary and the mandibular teeth cusps touching each other on the working side, producing simultaneous contact, which is known as balanced occlusion. Coming to the factors affecting balanced occlusion, these include firstly the condylar guidance. Next is the incisal guidance, then the orientation of occlusal planes, the compensating curves, and the cuspal inclination. These five factors together make up the Hanau squint. Hanau squint is a very important topic. Now let's revise again the five factors which make up the Hanau squint. First is the condylar guidance, then is the incisor guidance, then is the orientation of occlusal plane, compensating curves, and yes, finally the cuspal inclination. Now let's discuss each topic in detail. First is the condylar guidance. Condylar guidance is defined as the mandibular guidance generated by the condyle and articular disc traversing the contour of the articular eminence. This is according to GPT-9. Here is a diagram to explain how to measure the condylar guidance. In this diagram, the horizontal plane seen here indicates the Frankfurt's horizontal plane. This line here indicates the path traversed by the condyle along the articular eminence during protrusion. The angle formed by these two planes is the condylar guidance angle. Now let's understand the importance of condylar guidance as to why is it important in balanced occlusion. The condylar guidance is different for each patient and is measured by the doctor by recording the protrusive records. This condylar guidance helps the doctor to select the correct type of artificial teeth in developing occlusion for the patient. Now let's discuss the incisal guidance. Incisal guidance is defined as the influence of the contacting surfaces of the mandibular and maxillary anterior teeth on mandibular movement. This definition is according to GPT-9. This diagram will help us to understand what is incisal guidance. So let's understand it in detail. In this diagram, we can see a vertical and horizontal overlap between the maxillary and mandibular teeth. This vertical overlap which you can see here between the maxillary and mandibular incisal edge is what is known as the overbite, and this horizontal overlap seen between these two teeth is what is known as overjet. Now in this diagram we can see this horizontal plane present, which indicates the reference plane for the incisal guidance, and this line indicates the plane formed by joining of the incisal edges of maxillary and mandibular teeth. The angle formed by these two planes is the incisal guide angle. Now let's understand the importance of incisal guidance. Now in this diagram, the first part indicates on how the overjet and overbite forms the incisal guide angle. Now in the second part of the diagram, we can see how an increase in the overjet has led to an increase in the incisal guide angle. And the third part shows a further increase in the overjet, which has caused a further rise in the incisal guide angle. The unit used to express incisal guidance is degrees and is decided by the dentist when he arranges teeth. It is selected in such a way that the balance is produced in the occlusion. Now let's discuss the next factor affecting balanced occlusion, which is the orientation of occlusal plane. It is the average plane established by the incisal and occlusal surfaces of the teeth. This diagram will help us understand the orientation of occlusal plane in detail. The occlusal plane of the maxillary and mandibular occlusal rim, which has been shown in the diagram with a blue colored arrow, should be set parallel to the camper's line. The camper's line is formed by joining the ala of the nose and the tragus. The occlusal plane should also be set parallel to the interpupillary line. The interpupillary line is the line joining the two pupils of the eyes. Now let's discuss the next factor, which is compensating curves. There are different types of compensating curves, which include the curve of Speke, the curve of Wilson, the curve of Monsoon, and the curve of pleasure. Now let's begin with the first curve, which is the curve of Speke. It is defined as the anatomic curve established by the occlusal alignment of the teeth as projected onto the median plane, beginning with the cusp tip of the mandibular canine and following the buccal cusp tips of the premolar and molar teeth, continuing through the anterior border of the mandibular ramus, ending with the anterior most portion of the mandibular condyle as per GPT-9. This is a very important definition which needs to be remembered. This diagram here now will help us understand the curve of Speke in detail. Here we can see in this diagram on how the curve of Speke is formed. Here we can see the cusp tip of the mandibular canine and a curve extending from it towards the anterior most portion of the mandibular condyle. This is the curve of Speke, which is seen extending anteroposteriorly. Now let's discuss the next curve, which is the curve of Wilson. It is defined as the curvature of the cusp as projected on the frontal plane expressed in both arches. The curve in the mandibular arch being concave and the one in the maxillary arch being convex as per GPT-9. Now this diagram will help us understand the curve of Wilson. Now let's see the diagram in detail. Now this is the view as projected from the frontal plane. The curve extending mediolaterally here, touching the cusps of maxillary and mandibular teeth, is the curve of Wilson. Now let's understand the next curve, which is the curve of monsoon. It is defined as an ideal curve of occlusion in which each cusp and incisal edge touches or conforms to a segment of the sphere 8 inches in diameter with its center in the region of the glabella, as per GPT-9. This diagram will help us understand the curve of Wilson. Now this is the segment of the sphere, and the center of the sphere lies at the glabella. The radius of the sphere being 4 inches. This sphere present here is the curve of monsoon. Coming to the next curve, which is the curve of pleasure. It is defined as a helicoid curve of occlusion that, when viewed in the frontal plane, conforms to a mediolaterally convex curve in which the lingual surfaces of the teeth are more coronal to the buccal surfaces except for the last molars, which reverse that pattern, according to GPT-9. Now this diagram will help us understand the curve of pleasure. Now here we can see in this diagram on how the curve of pleasure is formed. Here we can see that the lingual surfaces of the teeth are more coronal to the buccal surfaces, which forms the mediolateral convex curve, except for in the last molars. This is what forms the curve of pleasure. The next factor is the cuspal inclination. It is the angle made by the average slope of a cusp with the cusp plane measured mesodistally or buccolingually. It is also known as the cusp angle. This diagram will help us understand the cuspal inclination. In this diagram, we can see this line indicates the cuspal incline. And this line here represents the horizontal plane. And this is the angle formed between the horizontal plane and the cuspal incline, which indicates the cusp angle. Now let's discuss about the Hanau squint. It consists of the condylar guidance, incisal guidance, the compensating curves, the orientation of occlusal plane, and the cuspal inclination. Now, there is an important formula which needs to be remembered as far as Hanau squint is concerned, which says that balanced occlusion is equal to the condylar guidance into the incisal guidance divided by the occlusal plane, cuspal inclination and compensating curves. This is a very important formula which needs to be remembered. Now, why is the understanding of the Hanau squint important? It is important since it helps in achieving balanced occlusion for the complete denture, which provides for the patient satisfaction as well as improves the masticatory efficiency for the patient, thereby improving the quality of life. Now, after balanced occlusion, let's discuss about monoplane occlusion. It is defined as an occlusal arrangement wherein the posterior teeth have masticatory surfaces that lack any cuspal height as per GPT-9. Now, this diagram will help us understand monoplane occlusion. Here in this diagram, we can see how monoplane occlusion has been achieved by the construction of balancing rams posteriorly. These balancing rams help in the development of monoplane occlusion. It is important to know the advantages and disadvantages of monoplane occlusion. So now let's start with the advantages. The first advantage of monoplane occlusion is that it is easy to arrange teeth in this type of occlusion. Also, it is useful in cases showing severe alveolar ridge resorption, skeletal abnormalities, and muscular incoordination. Coming to the disadvantages of monoplane occlusion, this type of occlusion produces a poor appearance to the patients, that is, and the development of unstable dentures in few cases. After monoplane occlusion, let's discuss about lingualized occlusion. This diagram will help us understand lingualized occlusion. Now let's see on how it is defined according to GPT-9. This form of denture occlusion articulates the maxillary lingual cusps with the mandibular occlusal surfaces in centric occlusion, working and non-working mandibular positions. Now here in this diagram we can see the articulation between the maxillary lingual cusps and the occlusal surfaces of the mandibular teeth. This type of articulation present between the upper and the lower teeth shows us on how the lingualized occlusion is formed. Coming to the advantages and disadvantages of lingualized occlusion. The first advantage of lingualized occlusion is that it has a more natural appearance of the maxillary posterior teeth. Also, it produces better chewing efficiency than monoplane occlusion. Coming to the disadvantage of lingualized occlusion, the teeth arrangement is quite difficult when it comes to lingualized occlusion. Now let's revise what we have learned till now about occlusion in complete dentures by solving some multiple choice questions. Question 1. Which of the following is not a part of Hanau squint? Option A. Condylar guidance. Option B. Balancing ramp. Option C. Incisal guidance. Option D. Compensating curve. Question 2. Which of the following is an anterior-posterior curve? Option A. Curve of Spee. Option B. Curve of Wilson. Option C. Curve of Monsoon. And option D. Curve of Pleasure. Coming to question 3, a shallow condylar guidance indicates the use of option A. Artificial teeth with longer cusps and deeper fossae. Option B. Artificial teeth with average cusps. Option C. Artificial teeth with shorter cusps and shallow fossae. And option D. None of the above. Take your time to answer these questions. You can later verify your answers by checking the description section below. Please like, comment, and subscribe to this channel to learn about various dental topics. You can ask us any other questions or give suggestions in the comment section below.